Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick, your most radically extreme favorite brother from an alternative mother. Praise God, from another mother. Hope you guys are doing all right. Praise God. I just want to thank the Lord, even though it can be tiring, but we've been doing these live videos on my other channel, which I guess I'll load this video on my regular channel too, Matthew Patrick Winfrey channel. The other channel, this is Church of the Firstborn every Sunday. By the grace of God, I try to make a Sunday sermon video, which this is one of those where I try to teach or, you know, preach regular for like a church service, brothers and sisters. But I started doing these live videos, so if you haven't seen them, I can't sit here and say I'll do one exactly what nights because of my schedule, brothers and sisters. I have a full-time ministry in the Philippines, and then a full-time, I spend lots of time ministering to individuals. I guess if someone has spent all their time making videos, you know, they can't have, you know, I wouldn't have time to minister to people. And that's more important. I mean, I don't care, of course, I want the messages that the Lord gave me to give out. I pray that the messages that the Lord would let me on Christian television or something where millions of people could get the message that the Lord gave me of repentance, revival, and preparing for the rapture. But my personal desire is to, you know, is to minister to people. And, you know, lots of times it's individual, brothers and sisters. It's individual. That takes a lot of time. And that's why these mega churches have, you know, a downside to that. You know, I know the mega church that I went to, where I was an altar worker while I was going to school, had like 5,000 people and they had 12 pastors. So 12 pastors and 5,000, you still can't do it. You still can't do it. I'd say a pastor is able to handle maybe 200 or 300 people at the maximum is a full-time job. There's always somebody in the hospital. There's always someone who died, you know, or someone, their unbelieving family needs prayer, you know, that needs intervention, drugs, alcohol, whatever, in jail, etc. So always something going on if you're a pastor. It's always in the middle of the night. It's always Saturday night, etc., when you go there. Just like the shootings that happen. I usually don't talk about the news, brothers and sisters. The ISIS attack that just happened in Orlando at this gay bar. I mean, all those gay people had family. They had family members who were Christians, I'm sure. And so, you know, even though those people were probably, you know, they're going to a bar doing drugs, drinking, and practicing a homosexual lifestyle, they had family members that are Christians, you know, who know the result of what happens when we die in our sins. And those people need comfort. Those people, this is an opportunity to evangelize, you know, the people that survived and their family members and all that, and that they can receive comfort and peace and joy and salvation and deliverance through Christ Jesus. So, you know, that's a busy time. If someone is a pastor and they have a member in that place, then they have, you know, a connection to all the people involved, you know, hundreds or thousands of people that connected to the people who were involved in the shooting and that were there at that place as an example, brothers and sisters. But like I say, usually don't talk about the news, but I'm going to be preaching as the Lord leads me about, you know, who our peace and joy is in Christ. I want to read this. So anyway, if you want to join us for the live videos, I've been doing them at 9 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, Eastern Daylight Time, which is where we're on now in the summertime, Eastern Standard Time. And so, you know, it's 8 Central, 7 Mountain, and 6 Pacific Time in the evening. And I've been doing it weekday nights, mostly Monday through Thursday. Most of those nights I've been on there. So Tuesday night, Brother Clark, who is the webmaster for the Church of the Firstborn and is also an elder, we have his Sunday school, you know, deep teaching videos on the Church of the Firstborn website. And again, it's even, you know, more extreme. Like you guys who watch my videos, you know, I'll say something like, people don't, you know, I don't have a giant audience watching my videos. I have, you know, a big audience compared to a church. I have more people watching my videos than the average church is like 250 people. So, you know, I have, say 1,000 people watch my video. If it's about the rapture, vision, or dream, 2,000 or 3,000 will watch it or more. But it's limited because I'm not on there. The people that have these great big channels, they're not preaching. They're talking about the news and sensationalized breaking news and all this all the time. And that's why they have audiences, not just Christians, but lots of people watching and, you know, for what's going on in the news, you know. And so Brother Clark, who will be on with me Tuesday, he's even more of a limited audience because it's not even just Christians who even want to hear preaching or be discipled, but people that want to actually literally dig into the Word of God And but we should all, brothers and sisters, anyone that's a Christian, God gave us a book. I mean, this is God's message to the world. And if we are Christians, we should want to know what God had to say, has to say, and had to say, and does continue to have to say, his eternal word right here. This is the basis of which we know about the gospel. We know about the gospel from the words. You know, that's what's so funny, too, of a lot of the, say, charismatic people. I'm a spirit-baptized person. You know, what they call a, you know, Pentecostal. Not the denomination, but a Pentecostal is someone, you know, a full gospel person. But as I mentioned before, there's something called charismatic. When you say charismatic, even though people use the word loosely, these words, the meaning of a charismatic is someone that is a spirit-filled person that doesn't know the word. I mean, that's the quickest shortcut way of saying it. Someone that has supposed to have been baptized in the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit, and their focus is on the gifts of the Spirit, not on the Word of God and the gifts of the Spirit together. And that's why that's my ministry right there, brothers and sisters, in a nutshell. You got charismatic churches that are having all of this New Age stuff introduced into the church. Like there's people on YouTube, and they'll say something like, well, you know, that some of them even say that outright that the Word of God is created by the man to keep people down, you know, by the Catholic Church and all this stuff. Totally untrue. That's how they get in false doctrine. You go look. There are people that say that the Catholic Church gave us the Bible. No, they did not. The Bible was around long before the Catholic Church. We have over 2,500 copies of the Bible, just the New Testament, not counting any Old Testament. It's the New Testament. Okay, let's just say New Testament. Old Testament, of course, also, like the Dead Sea Scrolls. We have 2,500 ancient manuscripts from before 250 A.D. So the Catholic Church really didn't even get its very start until the Council of Nicaea under Emperor Constantine there in Rome, you know, whatever it was. I used to know the date. It doesn't matter. 300 and something. It's 311, whatever it is, 345, whatever, after that. So we have 2,500 texts of the New Testament before that, plus the letters of the early church fathers like Polycarp and all those guys, the disciples of the disciples, and then their disciples and their disciples, they all wrote letters to each other, the different bishops in every city. There used to be a bishop in every city before it all was moved to Rome, and all of those bishops wrote letters to each other quoting from the Bible. So we have the whole Bible, the whole New Testament, but minus seven verses, they say. You can make a Bible, the one we have, as the one we have that's accurate and shows the one we have now is accurate from the letters that the early church fathers wrote to each other in the first, second, third century before the Council of Nicaea. All, I think it's seven Bible verses are not quoted in their letters to each other. You know, seven, you know, minor, insignificant Bible verses that aren't, you know, saying something, theology, etc. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so when people start telling you that the Bible we've had has been changed and all this kind of stuff, that's totally untrue, brothers and sisters. The original, the King James is true to the original ancient manuscripts all the way back to the beginning of the church age. This is the things that there are scholars who do these things. They're not, people on YouTube are not Bible scholars. So when they start telling you that the Word of God is inaccurate and it's not the original and all this, what they're doing is they're getting people not to accept the Word of God. And then they start saying stuff like, well, you know, I had a special vision from the Lord or a dream from the Lord that's, you know, that is equal to the Word of God. Now, brothers and sisters, there's some people, they I don't know what it is. People get confused. They can't understand, you know, they can't, what is not understand? They can't comprehend and synthesize information that they hear. So they would say, you know, I know there are some people that say, well, Brother Patrick, you had dreams and visions. Yes, I did, but they're in hand with the Word of God. I don't know why there's so many, well, maybe it's because of social media and the internet. There's so many people that are, well, I guess, I don't know, it's not illiterate, but they can't comprehend and they can't synthesize basic information. Someone can have a dream or a vision that, the Bible says that the spirit of prophecy is Jesus Christ. So, like, if you have watching my videos, I've been preaching for 16 years, but I've been making the, I was on the radio for 3 years before, back before I went to the Philippines, and then there's recordings of that, I guess, somewhere. And then I've been on YouTube for 4 or 5 years now. And so if you listen to the preaching that I do as a real ordained minister, who, you know, went to school and all that stuff, as the Lord led me, you know that when I give a vision or a word that the Lord gave me, it lines up and leads to the gospel always. People that's got all these words and it doesn't lead to the gospel, it doesn't lead to the Lord Jesus Christ, it doesn't give glory to God, it's not from God. That's how you know if a word is from the Lord or not. As Paul said in Galatians, he said, if I or an angel from heaven, if we, the apostles, or an angel from heaven, gives you a different gospel than the one that we gave you, let them be accursed, even angels. So when you start hearing all this stuff, there's all these new age people, you know, who are out here having romantic, dancing and hugging and rubbing the hair and neck of Jesus, is rubbing their neck and admiring the beauty of their neckline and their hair and all this, whatever kind of a demonic vomit that's being released on YouTube, and talking about some new doctrines and all this, and we don't, you know, and then we don't need to worry about the, you know, what the Bible says and et cetera, and sound doctrine, as Paul said, you know, that the generation is coming, the last generation, that cannot endure sound doctrine. They cannot accept sound doctrine. So they go into, as it says, they heap unto themselves teachers, you know, who'll say what they want to hear, and they get into doctrines of demons and all kinds of stuff, saying that, you know, even talking about that you're not supposed to get married and then not eat meat and all this stuff. Even talks about that. There are people on YouTube who have first denied that the Word of God is the Bible that we have is the inerrant Word of God. Now, I want to say this again as a secondary note. It is true that the NIV, the non-inspired version, and other versions have been, you know, the translation has been tampered with to lower the authority of Jesus Christ and things like that. That's true, brothers and sisters. As I encourage you to watch A Lamp in the Dark by Chris Pinto and A Tare Among Wheat, The Tares Among Wheat, two documentaries explaining how we got the King James Bible and then these other translations, how they've been tampered with, actually by the Jesuits, that's true, by the Catholic Church, and by, you know, liberal theologians in England, also involved, who none of these people are born again, people who are doing this, but they're hiding behind Christianity, claiming to be theologians, you know, and I just want to say that too. People claiming they're theologians. A theologian is someone that is a doctor of theology. There are no theologians on YouTube that are YouTube ministers. There are none that are doctors of theology. So that, you know, they're not theologians, brothers and sisters. But like myself, what I learned in my 4 years of Bible school, if there's something I don't know, I know where to look, I know where to research, and I know what experts that I can trust. Bible-believing, God-fearing, born-again, Bible-believing theologians are the ones you can go to. And that's what I'm saying. There are liberal theologians, like in Oxford University. Harvard University has theologians, but they don't even believe the Bible is the Word of God. Right here in Winston-Salem, they have a school, a theological seminary, even here at Wake Forest University. And I know a guy who used, when I was an altar worker, there was a man there who was an elder in the church. His son was going to that Wake Forest, a Masters of Divinity program, and he had to drop out because he believed that the Bible was the inerrant Word of God, and none of the professors did. They failed him on his papers because he was saying that the Bible was the inerrant Word of God. And that's not even, you know, this is in North Carolina. We're not talking Harvard or San Francisco or something. We're talking North Carolina. So the seminaries or cemeteries are full of liberals who don't even believe the Word of God. So that's why if someone wanted to go, you need to go to a conservative, born-again, Spirit-filled Bible school like the one I went to. It comes out of Springfield, Missouri Global University. It's the University of Assemblies of God. There's other places. I don't know, you know, enough about them to endorse them. But, you know, there's Oral Roberts or whatever, you know, 700 Club, Pat Robinson, they have Regent University, even though, you know, that Pat Robinson has said some controversial things, but his university is a true Bible-believing university, and Oral Roberts, same deal, not agreeing with everything Oral Roberts says, but they have conservative theologians there teaching the classes. I don't know why I'm talking about that. Is the Lord leading me, brothers and sisters? But anyway, brothers and sisters, we have to be rooted and grounded in the Word. And then also the Spirit. So that's where we get the Spirit and the Word come together. I talk about all this all the time, brothers and sisters. And the Lord is teaching me, you know, leading me to teach, like about healing, and to receive healing, receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And the baptism of the Holy Spirit has evidence, speaking in tongues, as I mentioned, those Bible verses, Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost, Acts chapter 8 in Samaria, Acts chapter 10 and 11 with Cornelius and his household, the Gentiles. Acts chapter 19, just to name a few, there at Ephesus, where Paul says to the disciples that he met there, have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? Acts chapter 19, verse 1 and verse 2 and 3. Paul goes there and he says to those disciples, have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? They already believed. They were already born again. Then he said, have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? They said, we didn't even know there was such thing as the Holy Spirit. Then Paul tells them about it. He water baptizes them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to complete, because they were Jewish people, obviously, who had been baptized to repentance. The baptism of John was a baptism of repentance. You know, that's another thing that's so funny. Because I started out as an assistant pastor in a Baptist church. And the Baptist senior pastor there, he had this little pocket guide thing that all, the Baptist preachers carry. And they trace their, ordination back to John the Baptist. And they talk about, John the Baptist and being a Baptist like John the Baptist. And then the thing about it is, as Paul tells us there in that text, and you read in the Gospels, the baptism of John was not a result of salvation. John the Baptist was in the Old Testament, even though that's what people don't think. Comprehend, brothers and sisters, and think. We read about John the Baptist in the beginning of the Gospels, but John the Baptist was not a born-again Christian, brothers and sisters. He lived before the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus Christ. He died before the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Matter of fact, he died as the ministry of Jesus began to increase, and he prepared the way of the Lord. He prepared. So his baptism, as it says in Acts 19, was a baptism unto repentance, not as a result of salvation. So that's where people get confused anyway. When we're baptized, Paul tells us that we're buried with Christ and resurrected with him, that the old man has passed away, and behold, all things become new. It's symbolic of resurrection of the spirit man and death of the flesh and ruling over our flesh by our spirit, by the spirit man within us. You know, that's the thing, just like speaking in tongues and all these other things, the Holy Spirit is leading us. We are led by the Holy Spirit, but it's not the Holy Spirit doing it. It says, like in Acts chapter 2, they spoke in tongues as the Holy Spirit gave them the utterance. But who spoke in tongues? The Holy Spirit spoke in tongues, or the person, the vessel? See, so the people spoke in tongues. The Holy Spirit gave them the utterance to do it. So when we're talking about living a holy life, the Holy Spirit is giving us the utterance, or leading us, as it said, those who are led by the Spirit. But we are the ones doing it. Our spirit, as it says in there in Romans chapter 8, his spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. Even as it says in the Old Testament, the spirit of a man is the candlestick of the Lord. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. It's not the Holy Spirit, but my spirit lit. The fuel for my spirit is the Holy Spirit. That's a whole other teaching. People got to, you got to get that. If you want to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you receive your healing and all that things, you got to get that in your head. I was going to preach, but the Lord is leading me on this teaching here. The fuel, the oil for the light is the Holy Spirit, but our spirit is the one that's lit, brothers and sisters. Our mouth is the one that speaks in tongues. Our mouth is the one that proclaims the gospel. Our hands are the ones who sin. When I do a sin, I'm doing a sin. And then when I'm doing something righteous, I'm the one doing it too. But not by the spirit of the flesh, as it says, the fruit of the flesh. People always talk about the enemy. Sometimes it is the enemy. But if you read in Galatians chapter 5, it talks about the fruit of the spirit. Galatians 5, 22 and 23. And then just right after that, it talks about the fruit of the flesh. The fruit of the flesh, which is all those bad things. You know, envy, strife, murder, all those things. It's the fruit of our flesh. And so when I'm doing something bad, we take responsibility. It's a sin. The devil may have tempted you. Demons may have demonized you and oppressed you, but you chose to sin. Unless someone is full-born demon-possessed and don't know, there's a spirit talking through them and they don't, they're blacked out. That would be an exception. But generally speaking, 99% of the time, we are in control of ourselves and we are the ones who choose to sin. And tempted or empowered by demons sometimes in our own flesh. And then also when we do things for the Lord, we are willingly offer yourselves as a living sacrifice. So we choose to do it, but the oil, the fuel, the power, the dunamis, as it says in the Greek, is coming from the Spirit of the God. You shall, from God, as Jesus said in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost has come upon you to be a witness for me in Judea, Samaria, and the other outposts of the world. And so that's the call of the church, to make disciples of the nation. That's what the church has failed to do so much so in so many ways. And we could talk about the past. When I say the church, brothers and sisters, we can't be responsible for what happened, you know, with the Inquisitions and all that 1,000 years ago or whatever. I'm talking about right now in our generation, brothers and sisters, in our own selves, in our own churches, in our own life. We are responsible for what's going on in our flesh. And that's the word from the Lord I'm getting. And this, you know, like I say, I get a word from the Lord, brothers and sisters. I had no idea. I was going to talk about something else, Hebrews 3:1. And by the grace of God, I'll get to it later. That's the message I tried to do last night, and the Lord wouldn't let me do it. That's why I decided to do it today. Now I know. I guess the Lord is wanting me to give this other message that we are responsible, brothers and sisters. We are responsible for ourselves and for how the church is seen in the world. The Lord, through His people. Hallelujah. But we have to offer ourselves as living sacrifice. So that's what it is, brothers and sisters. That is the problem that we have. Let's say the short version. There's a book, which I haven't read the book, but I've listened to preaching by those preachers who talk about it, like Leonard Ravenhill, awesome man of God, Duncan Campbell, all these people, Paris Reedhead, these guys who have died now, who preach revival in the old days, and the most recent one probably David Wilkerson, famous people. Brothers and sisters, why does revival tarry? Because the church is not seeking God and not calling for it. 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people who would call by my name would humble themselves and pray, turn from their wicked ways, seek my face, I would hear from heaven, I will forgive their sins, and I will heal their land. 2 Chronicles 7:14. So we have to turn from our wicked ways, brothers and sisters. We all have sin in our lives. I don't care, you know, if it's just a heart of, you know, some people like, you know, they're judgmental and self-righteous. Now, we know, as an example, let's talk about what happened in Orlando, since that's in the news today. Look, there's lots of Christians that talk about, yeah, I have relatives. They're all Baptists. All my relatives are Baptists. Talking about killing, that we need to kill the gay people and all this. Look, homosexuality is a sin, and it's an abomination to God. We know about Sodom and Gomorrah and all that. But we as Christians are not called to go around here shooting people and condemning people. We are called to evangelize them, to be salt and light to them. And, you know, God's Spirit is the one that brings condemnation and repentance. But we give the Word of God. We evangelize those people. Every one of us probably has a homosexual, almost every single person, I guess it is every single person, has a homosexual relative. There are people that watch my videos who comment all the time who are, you know, have homosexual desires or homosexual tendencies, but they tell me they're living a celibate life, but they desire to be homosexual. And they pray, you know, to be delivered from that. And brothers and sisters, these people are people too and eligible for salvation, just like anybody else. And so we need to evangelize them. And I want to say this too. There are liberal denominations, of course, who say that it's not a sin. They say things that, you know, as an example, this is a great example. They say homosexuality is not a sin. And that is wrong. It is a sin. But it's not our job. We all sin. Everybody sins in lots of different ways. People have pride, self-righteousness, arrogance, judgmentalness, whatever, you know, greediness, covetousness, whatever. You know, we all have sin in our lives. Even a heterosexual man, you know, you see a woman in a bikini or whatever, you know, you can't help in the United States. You know, they have, you know, if you went to the beach or swimming pools or whatever, there it is in your face, you know, because of our horrible society that we live in. People let their teenage daughters run around dressed like what would be, you know, considered a prostitute clothes, you know, 50 years ago. And now it's the norm. And then if you don't let your kid do it, they're liable to call the social workers on you or whatever, you know, call the police on you or something because you don't let them wear, you know, a bikini and a miniskirt and all this, 15 years old, and they're very, you know, flirty and all this running around. I mean, this is a culture that we're in, you know, where there's so much, and then pornography on the internet, all these things, whatever, so much temptation for all people. So none of us are perfect. We all have desires, whether even it's gluttony. You know, look at in America, they have the buffets where all you can eat. And, you know, like in Las Vegas, when I was out there, you know, they have all these places with all this rich food. And it's just gluttony promoted. And besides all the other things that's promoted in Las Vegas, even myself, of course, I'm, you know, what is the right word? I'm disturbed by all of these other things that go on in Las Vegas. You know, all the smoking and drinking and gambling and there's even prostitutes there and all this kind of stuff walking around and all these things. But even that, if you just say, well, like myself, when I was in Las Vegas, I was like, well, I'll try to, you know, try some of these foods that I've never tasted and go to something like this, a buffet and all that. But that's still gluttony and all these things, brothers and sisters. There's people in the world with no food. You know what I'm saying? People with hardly nothing to eat. And then there's all this gluttony and waste in America and in first world countries like Europe too or whatever, where people, especially America, is the worst. We have all this waste and all this decadence. It's just horrible, brothers and sisters, when you look at people like in the Philippines. Like I leave the Philippines and millions of people live on $2 a day. The average Filipino lives on $2 a day. And then you've got all these millions of kids. Like the feeding programs, if you go to the Facebook group and look at the kids, the poor kids that we feed and do, you know, vacation Bible stuff with them, read Christian storybooks and little singing songs about, you know, Jesus loves me, this I know, etc., and evangelize them and put the seed in their heart of the gospel, and all of these, you know, 1,000 kids a month or a week that we do with the feeding programs, and then the orphans and all that, and then you go to a place like in the U.S., like Las Vegas as an example, you see all this abundance of food. Here, even here, all the grocery stores so full of food and all that. On every corner, we've got grocery stores. Even when I was in Europe, I lived in Germany for 7 years. They don't have a TV in every room, and they don't have 2 or 3 cars and all that. The Europeans, because of their, you know, they say that, well, they're good with money. No, it's also their standard of living is not the same. I don't care what anybody tells you. I've been all over Europe, and I don't care what the statistics say. They're looking at an average of people that live in government project housing, too, and all that. But I'm talking about the average American that it has is a working, that works and has a, you know, a suburban life and all that, middle-class people, professionals and non-professionals, you know, people work at factories, et cetera, too, make good money. Everybody's got a TV in every room. They've got, you know, 2 or 3 cars and all this stuff. The average American has all this kind of stuff. Brothers and sisters, you just don't know if you haven't been to these places like the Philippines and all that, or in Africa and all these places where people are starving. And so that's the thing about it, brothers and sisters. We have a choice, and that's what I'm trying to get to. The message from the Lord is the Lord has had me thank the Lord. The message that I've had since I started the ministry is duties of a Christian in the last days. The first sermon I ever preached in the last February, Sunday night in 2001. I still have my notes. I used to make all these extensive notes when I first started the first 6 months or a year. I used to study and study and study and make notes because I didn't know the Bible verses and learning it, trying to remember the Bible verses and all that. Duties of a Christian in the last days. And it's not just talking about the rapture. That's the reason why, you know, I get lots of dreams and visions from the Lord, and I would say 90% I don't make any videos about. Because, brothers and sisters, and then when I do put my dreams and visions, lots of times I don't put it in the title. Those of you guys who watch me regularly, I'm not casting my pearls before swine as much as I can. If there's any way I could totally eliminate control who watches the videos, who the Lord would have it watch, that's what I would do. Because there's so many people who are running to and fro talking about they're going into rapture, looking for the rapture. And those are the very people, brothers and sisters. Because they show, you know, you reap what you sow. They sow no mercy. They sow no love. They don't care, not just about the 3 orphanages that we have or the 1,000 kids we feed every week. They don't care about those things. They don't want to hear about anything like that. They don't care about, you know, the families and those, you know, those people killed in that gay bar, and they definitely don't care about, you know, their families, their relatives, all these things going on. Their heart is, you know, is so cold, but yet they're talking about, you know, they're a Christian and all this, brothers and sisters. This is what I deal with. This is what we see every day. That's why we don't have rapture, or we don't have revival. It's probably why we don't have rapture either, because the bride's not ready. And that's what I'm trying to do, get the bride ready to meet the Lord. That's what my ministry is all about. But the process of getting ready is not sitting around calculating the rapture date. And I want to say this. I'm going to be straight up. I need to make a separate video about it. I am a compassionate person as much as I can, brothers and sisters. I have people that call me and message me and talk to me all the time trying to calculate the rapture date. And I've entertained them. I've spent hours I could have been making videos for people to get saved, having repeating and repeating conversations with people who are obsessed about calculating the rapture day. All those hours I could have spent praying for the sick, you know, and all those things, and making videos of it and teaching about healing or about whatever, any topic that the Lord would have me do. And I've done it to be compassionate and sympathetic and empathetic to people who have lots of problems, who are just dying for the rapture to be today because of their own personal problems. And brothers and sisters, I'm just beyond my limit with it. I've been saying it for a year or two. I'm going to stop dealing with these people and do the job that the Lord gave me to do. And that's the job that the Lord gave me to do. Prepare the bride for the rapture. And what does it take? It takes holiness, pureness and holiness, brothers and sisters. As I was singing the song, I made those live videos. I encourage you to watch them. The Spirit was flowing mightily in the live videos I've been making. And the Lord had led me to sing this song the other day, you know. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. And that's it, brothers and sisters. We have to be ready to meet the Lord in the air. That's why Jesus said in Luke 21:36, after he was talking about the tribulation, he said, "Watch and pray, therefore, and pray always that you be counted worthy to escape these things, the tribulation, stand before the Son of Man." The Lord told us that. And brothers and sisters, by the grace of God, I will not entertain any more people who are sitting around calculating the rapture date based off, you know, their shoe size times the date times the circumference of the earth and all these things. And God have mercy on me that I won't have to, that I'm not going to entertain that nonsense anymore. And I'm not going to entertain all of the latest, you know, the latest trend on the internet of all kinds of different wacky stuff, brothers and sisters. I'm not going to get involved in it. And then by the grace of God, I have few backbiters, but I have people who backbite me. They tried to get me to do their will. I've had, you know, a string of them, people who wanted to have, you know, for me to leave my wife and be with them, who wanted me to, you know, have a relationship with them, that they would, you know, personally be, you know, rich people who want to be my personal, you know, I'd be their personal pastor. They would own me. And then I would preach and teach what they wanted. They would use my ministry so they could have some kind of a ministry through me and control me and pay me. I mean, very wealthy people. And I refuse, brothers and sisters, thank you, Lord, by the grace of God, not to sell out to being controlled like most pastors and most churches are controlled and owned and told what to say and what they can and cannot say, or they'll be fired by, you know, by the elders and deacons of churches. Brothers and sisters, I work with thousands of pastors. I would say 75 to 80% of pastors are told what they can and can't say. There's that when they try to get hardcore, there'll be the major donors of the church will tell them, "Hey, if you keep talking about that, I'll stop tithing. I'll leave the church." I've seen it hundreds of times. But by the grace of God, by the grace of God, the Lord knows I will never do that. And I guess that's why I'm not pastoring a church. I planted churches, and I never took any money from any of those churches, brothers and sisters. They tried to give me money and tried to control me too. It ain't going to happen. I'm going to preach what the Lord calls me to preach, what the Lord tells me to preach, when he tells me to preach it, by the grace of God, by the grace of God, brothers and sisters. So that's the thing. If you want to hear the truth and don't, you know, and can accept correction, you're in the right place. This ministry, Church of the Firstborn, because I'm bound and determined by the grace of God not to be bought, not to be sold out, not to be afraid of any man, as Jesus said. You know, don't fear the one that can throw you into hell fire. Or don't fear the one that can kill your body, but fear the one that can throw your body and soul into hell. That's, of course, the Lord himself is our judge. So that's the sermon I was going to do, and I'll just say that. It's Hebrews chapter 3, verse 1. Therefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Christ Jesus. That's the verse I wanted to tell you about. Consider Jesus. That's the sermon I wanted to do. Consider Jesus. You know, people considering about ISIS or about all these other things. Consider Jesus. And that's what I'm trying to tell you, brothers and sisters. I'm not considering giving the messages that people that want to, you know, that want to give a bunch of money or sponsor me or have me as their, you know, like a kept pastor. They want to control me and I'll be their personal chaplain. I don't consider them. I don't consider their money. I don't consider how we will sponsor the orphanages or how we will sponsor the feeding programs. I consider Jesus. I consider Jesus, who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we could ask or think. Now, the problem is now I can't really preach that hard because there's people around upstairs, and I'm trying not to, you know, I want to preach it, brothers and sisters, hallelujah. But praise God Almighty, brothers and sisters, I consider the Lord Jesus Christ only. I consider the Lord Jesus Christ, and I don't consider what other people think, brothers and sisters. Because, let me say this, when Jesus walked the earth, he was sympathetic to the sinners, to the prostitutes, to the drunkards, to the tax collectors. He was very hardcore on the religious leaders, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Herodians, all of those guys, the teachers of the law, and the scribes and Pharisees. That's who he was hard on. But he had considerate heart toward the sick and the lame, the halt, the maimed. As he said, you know, the sick are the ones who need a doctor, not the healthy. You know, and so that's the thing about it, brothers and sisters. We have to seek and save the lost and consider those people who are separated from God. Because the Lord has come to seek and save the lost, brothers and sisters. So consider Jesus Christ. When you're worried about ISIS, when you're worried about, you know, even though, you know, of course, if Hillary Clinton is elected, I believe the United States is over with. Anyway, just in the natural, if Hillary Clinton wins, we're going to lose, you know, she's going to appoint Supreme Court justices to take away our constitutional rights of, you know, they'll make, you know, saying that homosexuality is a sin, hate speech, take away people's right to bear arms and all this. I know that's what they want to do. That's what's going to happen as we go into the tribulation, you know, as we move toward the tribulation. But brothers and sisters, ultimately, we cannot look at those things. We have to look to Jesus. We have to look to Jesus and consider Jesus. He is the author and finisher of our faith. He is our high priest and apostle. He's ever making intercession for us at the right hand of the Father. I just want to add this on here. I had a dream. And in my dream, you know, if you guys know, if you've been watching my videos, the Lord had led me in the past. I made a video for which to pray for Alex Jones because I had a dream of him being persecuted and under house arrest. And that it was because of, you know, he keeps talking about the gospel too. Even though Alex Jones doesn't believe in the rapture, I don't care. He's a brother in Christ, and he talks about Jesus as the answer to all the New World Order stuff all the time. Even though he's not a preacher, and he's not perfect, for sure, nobody is. Alex Jones is definitely not a preacher, and he says some bad stuff too. But he's our brother in Christ who's on the way to getting, you know, fully right with God, I'll put it that way. But I had another dream about Alex Jones and his teaching. And in my dream, it was on the side of this. He had a big old glass castle. And he was teaching there about the rise of the New World Order in that big glass castle. And through the walls of the glass castle, I could see this mountain, brothers and sisters. I could see this mountain. And I could just see a little piece of it. And I was like, man, that's a beautiful mountain. I kept looking at it. And then Alex Jones was jumping up and down. You know, he's very entertaining and very, you know, showman, but he tells the truth, but he can get on your nerves. You know, women don't like it. Just like Trump, you know, in a way, you know, a lot of women don't like that aggressive personality, but, you know, there's a time to be aggressive. There's a time to be aggressive. That's why, you know, my preaching style too. You know, there's a lot of, you know, women that, they're probably men too, women who like a, you know, Joel Osteen type talking, you know, sweet little effeminate man, but, you know, I'm not one of those, and neither is Trump or Alex Jones as an example. But, you know, they're different in their different worlds. Trump is in the political world and the business world. Alex Jones is in the, you know, entertainment / reporting the New World Order world. Of course, I'm in the ministry, but still different parts that God needs all those kind of people in different areas of the world, brothers and sisters. But anyhow, so I kept looking at that thing, and Alex Jones was jumping around and getting more show off, you know. So I was like, well, I'm going to go outside because it's starting to just be a little bit too much of a show here for me. So I went outside. I kept looking at that mountain. Then I realized, brothers and sisters, that I was just looking at his castle was just like just a little tiny sand, grain of sand compared to that mountain. And I began to back up and look at that mountain. And the mountain was so big and beautiful, brothers and sisters, it filled the whole infinite space. And it was the most beautiful. There was all these different parts of the mountain, you know, alpine and snow over here and alpine here, and then all these rocks like what you might see it there at Yosemite, or then even also like Mount Rushmore. You know, the mountains were so, you know, like a giant boulders and all that, so beautiful. And then I began to back up and see how giant it was, and then Alex Jones's little glass castle was so small. brothers and sisters, and I realized that that was the mountain of God. That is the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's so beautiful and big. And so that dream I had probably about 3 or 4 weeks ago, and by the grace of God, I've been having dreams almost every night for the last 2 or 3 months. As I said, I don't share 90% of them. And the visions either that the Lord gives me, I don't share. I just as the Lord would lead me. But the point of that dream was, is of course, Alex Jones is just a little tiny speck of what's going on. But instead of looking at those things, which you know, we need to be informed of what's going on, but to look and inquire the kingdom of the Lord, to consider Jesus, the author and finish of our faith. He is that, the mountain that fills the earth from the dream of King Nebuchadnezzar, Daniel chapter 2. There's a stone that's not cut out with hands, a stone that's thrown and destroys the statue of the kingdoms of man. You know, a stone is thrown by God and destroys the statue of the dream of King Nebuchadnezzar, which represents the kingdoms of man all the way down to the Antichrist kingdom. And then that stone becomes a giant mountain and fills the whole earth. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. And so that's why the message that I tried to make in my video last night, and what I'm getting to here, is consider Jesus. If all Christians, if all of you, even just the people that watch this video, if we as a group, you know, I studied all this revival history. For about a year, I studied and read, you know, the writings of people that experienced real revival. Real revival. And I've had some revival break out in my ministry in the Philippines probably about 4 or 5 times. And I almost had revival break out in Charlotte last weekend on Sunday night at a church. Maybe 25% of revival. They just weren't ready for it. But revival starts even with just two people. As Jesus said, if two or more gathered in my name, there I am in the midst of them. And if those two people are more, if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, not sitting there, oh, look at those queers, look at those homosexuals, look at those faggots, or whatever, you know, hate, you know, insults people would hurl and condemning and judgmental of other people. God says, if my people, that's us, who are called by my name, that's us, would humble themselves, not humble those other people, humble yourself, and pray, and turn from your wicked ways, my wicked ways, not about what them gay people need to do. We need to turn from our wicked ways and seek his face. Seek his face, not seek his hand. And I've said this before, I've touched on pieces of this in every video I do. Most people, like even if they're looking for healing, there's people that email me almost every day about they're trying to get healed. And God heals people, period. God heals people, period. It's by, you know, you receive it by faith like salvation. But instead of seeking healing, seek the healer. Instead of seeking the baptism of the Holy Spirit, we're seeking the one who baptizes us in the Holy Spirit. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why getting saved is not really seeking salvation. It's seeking the Lord, the one, the judge. It's seeking the Lord. Being a Christian, as they all these denominational cliche that they say in the old dead denominations, you know, have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, but yet they say a sinner's prayer and then that's it. Then they have no more. God doesn't talk to people anymore, just the Bible only. And then they're talking about they got a personal relationship with Jesus. When they pray, they petition and petition and petition their demand list to God. And then they call that a personal relationship with Jesus. A personal relationship with Jesus is, I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still long, the roses and the voice I hear falling on my ears, the sound of God discloses. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, no other has ever known. That's in the garden. I come to the garden alone. That's it. Go to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses. Hallelujah. I go there to meet the Lord. He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet that the birds hush their singing. Hallelujah. I come to the garden alone. That's what it is. That's what the Lord told me one time, brothers and sisters. When I was praying and talking to the Lord said, I just want to walk. I just want to walk with my people in the cool of the day. That's it. The Lord wants to walk with us in the cool of the day, just like He did Adam. That's what it's all about. That's why it's His story, history. The Bible is called, is the theme of the Bible is the redemption of man. The redemption of man. God made a plan for the redemption of man. That's what it's all about, brothers and sisters, with God. He came to seek and save the lost. That's what it's about. The greatest of these is love, or charity in the King James, giving, sacrificial, agape love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Without love, I am nothing. That's what it's all about with God, brothers and sisters. Love. God loves sinners, and He wants them to repent. He wants them to repent. He wants them to repent. Lots of times, like Gandhi said, you know, Christianity would be a great religion if it wasn't for the Christians, you know. And it's true, brothers and sisters, of most people. We choose daily to walk with God or not. We choose to offer ourselves a living sacrifice or not. We choose to be a sanctuary. That's why you have to seek the Lord and ask Him. Like that song that I was singing in the live video, I was singing again. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy unto Thee. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy unto Thee. Call upon the name of the Lord today, brothers and sisters. Ask Him to make you a sanctuary. Seek the Lord. In that process is healing, salvation, evangelism, of baptism of the Holy Spirit, gifts of the Spirit, fruit of the Spirit, all that. That's why it's called fruit of the Spirit. You have to have a tree with roots to have fruit. Without roots, there's no fruit. You've got to have roots to have fruit. That's a whole other sermon. All these little nuggets I'm dropping are all sermons. I could preach all day long on any one of those by the Spirit of God and by His Word. With no roots, there's no fruit, brothers and sisters. That's why it says in Psalm chapter 1, you know, those who read the words of the Bible, of the Psalms, it's like a tree planted by the still water. They shall not be moved. That's why the old song, you know, I shall not be moved. But now the problem with a lot of religious people, that the old denominations that sing that song, I shall not be moved. Well, sometimes the Spirit of the Lord needs to move us off our, you know, our blessed assurance that we might go out and do the will of God. Our brothers and sisters, I'm going to close this video out. God bless you all. May the peace of God be with you today in the name of Jesus Christ. For He is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all you can ask or think, brothers and sisters. To God be the glory. Great things He has done. Hallelujah. Even the vilest of sinners who truly believes, they can be born again. Hallelujah. Praise God Almighty. To God be the glory. Great things He has done. Hallelujah. Praise God Almighty, brothers and sisters. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be His name. Hallelujah. Father, I pray right now for the people who would want to be a part of the Church of the Firstborn, Lord God, that we are here, Lord God. Even as dear brothers and sisters have, you know, tried to help me organize the ministry, but I'll say this. The organizer of this ministry is the Lord Himself, not me. That's why I purposely, Lord, keep the ministry not to be overly organized, because I know, Lord God, that You walk among the people and You call them to You and they have free will to go to and fro, whatever. They have to choose to offer themselves as a living sacrifice daily. As Paul said, Lord, in Your word, I die daily. Jesus said, he who does not take up his cross daily and follow me is not worthy of me. Even as the Lord said in the Gospel of Luke. So Father, right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, we choose to be holy, set apart unto You, my Master, ready to do Your will. Thank You, Lord Jesus. I choose to be holy, set apart for You, my Master, ready to do Your will. Father, we give You the praise and the glory, Lord, right now. Lord, we receive, Lord God, the high calling that we have in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Father. We praise your holy name, Lord God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, I just issue that to you from the Lord. There's a high calling of God in Christ Jesus. The narrow road, the Appian way. Hallelujah. Isaiah 35, I-35. Walk in the middle thereof. Don't veer into the right or to the left, but walk on the Appian way, the highway of holiness. Hallelujah. Grace be unto God, and peace from our Lord Jesus Christ be upon you today, brothers and sisters. For he who has gathered you shall not let you be scattered. Hallelujah. But he who has begun a good work in you will see it through until the end. For the Lord is with us, and he's for us and not against us. Hallelujah. Praise God Almighty. The Lord is for us and not against us, as he says. All these things I says from the word of God. Brothers and sisters, he is for us and not against us. Hallelujah. If God be for you, who can be against you? Hallelujah. Greater is he who is in me than he who is in the world. 1 John 4:4. Hallelujah. It's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. Zechariah chapter 4, I believe, too. Praise God Almighty. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God Almighty. Father, we thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into him and they are saved. Hallelujah. He's mighty in battle. Hallelujah. Praise the name of God. Praise the name of Jesus. I will praise the name of Jesus. He's my rock. He's my fortress. He's my deliverer. In him will I trust. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. God bless you all, brothers and sisters. I'll be back on live by the grace of God Monday night at 9 o'clock. Tuesday night, Brother Clark will be on. He'll be doing some deep, deep teaching. I don't know exactly what yet. We haven't talked about it. I don't know what the Lord's leading him to talk about. As God makes a way, it'll be very interesting, very good stuff. We'll be ready for Q&A and go really digging deep. Because when Brother Clark and I start talking, we start getting into the deep, meat of the word. There's other people I talk to, we get into the spiritual stuff. But with Brother Clark, the other side, which is just as great and equal, you know, the Word and the Spirit together. So that's why we have to be in both camps, brothers and sisters, both sides of the fence, as I want to say this real quick. When they built the tabernacle in the wilderness, they had these two ropes that held up the fence that went around the tabernacle in the wilderness. And there was two ropes with these silver spikes. And, you know, and that is an example. As I used to do teaching a long time ago, I used to teach Sunday school on that, all these things that are types and shadows about Christ. And then this particular type and shadow of those two ropes is the Spirit and the Word. You know, that's the type and shadow in the whole type and shadow of the tabernacle in the wilderness, the temple, Solomon's temple, all pointing, you know, being fulfilled in Christ and his body. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you all.